bring disgrace on our blood if he and my mother were the first. And I had never seen him cry before, but he cried. And even though I was always pleading with my mom to leave him, I cried too. My mom is, I feel like I should be showing you some of these photos I have. That's my mom there, and that's my dad and me, that's my mom. My mom is a whirlwind of charisma, creativity, and action. She agreed reluctantly to go out with my father, and then coerced by the picture he painted, she married him with pragmatic resolve 6 months later. They would have smart children together, she would stay home and keep house, and he would be a stable husband, parent, and provider, a corrective to her own fatherless childhood. My dad didn't know that she'd only recently kept 38 cats in a two-bedroom apartment and been profiled in the Dallas Morning News as president of the area cat club. Membership had really taken off during her term, which isn't surprising. She's always been really good at evangelizing for her passions. And less than a decade later, she started a church in our living room, ministering to downtrodden people rather than stray animals. She hadn't been raised religious at all, but when her conversion came, it was swift and feverish. And later I learned that there were other female ministers in a family line of hers, of ours, that went back to an early accused witch in Massachusetts. While my father idolized his ancestors, my mom saw hers and his as figures of fun and fascination, ripe for storytelling. And as her religious fervor gathered steam, she also started to see them as harbingers of trouble in our own lives. She believed in something called generational curses, a certain kind of fundamentalist Christian concept that by doing any sinful or ungodly thing, such as cheating on your spouse or on your taxes or reading horoscopes, you would curse your family, yourself and your children's children, and so on, for seven generations. Demons literally infiltrated you, she believed, and you passed them on. So my parents didn't really agree on very much, is the short version, and sometimes toward the end of their marriage, my father would wake her up in the wee hours of the night by shining a flashlight under his face and continuing an argument they had been having hours earlier. And furthermore, he would say, and just sort of continue the argument. So luckily they did divorce, and their union though lives on, in some sense, in me. And I have never been able to stop trying to figure out what that means. But I didn't expect to become interested in genealogy. I associated it with the begats of the Bible, that family tree I told you about, and my father's reverence for the Old South. When I did start researching my family, slowly at first, and then in great gusts of extreme obsession, I thought of it as a kind of scattershot, backward-looking detective work. I wasn't interested in my father's side. This is his side here. This is my great-grandfather right there. He managed this plantation in the middle of the 1900s, and I guess that used to be the office where he worked. I was only interested in my mother's side. So her father had supposedly been married 13 times, and his father had supposedly killed a man with a hay-hook. So I wondered, is this really true? Did he really marry 13 times, and did he really kill a man with a hay-hook? And I've learned a surprising amount since then. But let's start with this picture of my grandparents. These are my mom's parents. And I love this photo because I think it really captures my grandmother's general attitude about him. I adored my grandmother. She was my favorite person in the world, and every time his name came up, that was the look she had in her face. So here he is then with many of the other women he was involved with over time. And here are some letters. This is like a trilogy of love affair letters. This one right here is the one that he wrote to my grandmother after she left him when she found out that he was, he wrote this to her when she found out that he was cheating on her. And my grandmother wrote this to the wife of the woman he was, husband of the woman he was cheating on her with. And this letter was from the other woman. So, and the other woman actually is sitting next to him there at the table on the left of the photo there. So I haven't confirmed that that my grandfather married 13 times, but I have confirmed at least 7 marriages and possibly 10. And if you look here, you will notice that these are some divorce orders, and the dates actually are all within 15 months of each other. So this particular set of divorces all happened within 15 months. And one of these marriages, the middle one, actually ended because his wife shot him in the stomach. So, according to the Dallas Morning News, the couple had been married only a few weeks. And that's the house where it happened, down here. And just for context, that's my grandfather there with my mom. I also confirmed that, and thank you to the Dallas Public Library, because they've really helped me a lot with this research. I also confirmed that his father really did kill a man with a hay hook. I had always imagined his father, though, as a real hothead, kind of like the bad guy in an old Western. And it turns out that the other guy, whose name was George Grimes, attacked him first. And he attacked him, actually, for a testimony that my great-grandfather had given in a trial. Grimes had been accused of trying to rape his stepdaughter. And I found her testimony here. It's probably good that it's too small to read it, so it's really harrowing stuff. So my attitude about him changed a lot. I had made a lot of jokes about him. And then I discovered that he was kind of a good guy. And then I discovered that he died in a mental institution and was buried behind it in an unmarked grave. And so eventually I put this stone on it because it really bothered me that was the way things had gone for him. But I did not become interested in my father's family until my mother told me that his father, the Newton family, or grandfather, the Newton family patriarch, had once chastised her for asking questions about his lineage and then changed the subject. And this was weird, you know, because I told you my father was so into blood and bloodlines and how rarefied our bloodline was. And also, his grandfather was a man who really liked to hold forth and tell people what to do. He was literally the kind of guy who told the women at a restaurant table what they were going to eat and then ordered for them. So given his narrative of allegiance to blood, the Newton family's caginess about our actual origins amused and intrigued me. And soon I was spending entire weekends working backward through history, trying to figure out what was going on with that. So I see we're kind of running a little bit shorter on time. So this is a will that I found. This is unfortunately one of my slave-owning ancestors. He he left some of his slaves to his family. And there's a lot of this kind of stuff in my family background, and it's really painful to confront it, but I also think it's really important, because if we don't think about these things and sort of what they mean for us, for this whole country now, then we just kind of stay in denial about the ways that history continues to reverberate. So I started posting some of this stuff on my website in 2007, and now I'm writing a book about it. And it's very personal, obviously, but it's also about the science and superstition of ancestry more generally, about what we inherit from our parents and from their parents before them, and to what extent that inheritance is hardwired in us. It's about our longing to know our ancestors, and in knowing them, to know ourselves. Genealogy is an ancient human preoccupation, and some scholars call it the oldest form of logic. And it's just changed so much in recent years. It used to be a province of kings and nobles, and now we can all do it. And we can compile our trees, we can take DNA tests, try to figure out how we're all related to each other. And you know, as AJ's, as this whole event really underscores, you know, one day we're probably going to be able to figure out exactly how we're related genetically to everyone else on the planet, which is a pretty amazing thing to contemplate. But we're also living in an era of these databases, these large databases of counseling that purports to tell parents in more and more detail what kind of children they can have together. And the industry is just growing on all fronts, raising enormous questions about identity, privacy, genetic engineering, and forcing us to consider the extent to which we believe in genetic predestination and the extent to which we believe that human beings have the power to forge their own identities. So while my own family history is endlessly engrossing to me, my interest in the subject is as universal as it is personal. It begins with my own experiences, and it stretches out endlessly. I'm really drawn in particular to stories about strange echoes down through the ages, and to our hopes and fears about those echoes, because they make me feel less alone with my own. The family of the great writer Bertrand Russell almost torpedoed his first marriage by terrifying him about the possibility of madness in the blood. "I'm haunted," he wrote, "by the fear of the family ghost." And Kurt Vonnegut speculated about the source of his own depression, whether it was related to his family. Joan Didion has written again and again about her ancestors and how she sees connections between their life and hers. These are some other writers I really respect who've written about this kind of material. Emily Ratajkow wrote a book about visiting the African diaspora, searching for her identity in her ancestors' homeland. She said she inherited her sense of displacement from her father, whose grandfather was murdered in the state of Mississippi in 1943. And she took on her father's feelings of homelessness, like a gene for being left-handed. The writer Naomi Alderman discovered toward the end of researching her last novel that her writer and inventor grandfather had been fascinated by the same passage from a book that inspired her to write her last novel. And Celeste Ng's great-grandfather came to the United States as what was called a paper son, by pretending to be the son of a Chinese man who was already here. Traditionally, she says each Chinese family has a poem that records its lineage, but her family's was lost along the way. So I'm really interested in these stories. I'm really interested in the ways in which genetics and our understanding of genetics are changing the ways that we're exploring our ancestry. Over time, the simplest facts of human existence have become the most unfathomable to me. We come from our parents who came from their parents, who descended, as the Bible would put it, from their fathers and their fathers' fathers. We begin with one man and one woman, and then we enter the world and we become ourselves. Beyond all that's encoded in our chromosomes, our hair, eyes, and skin of a certain shade, our frame and stature, our sensitivity to bitter tastes, we're bundles of opinions and ambitions, of shortcomings and talents, and every one of our ancestors had hopes and fears, good days and bad. Every one of them took actions or were forced into situations that shaped them and that led to us. Every human being on Earth is a particular individual, consisting of parts from other particular individuals, and the alchemy between our genes and our individuality is a mystery we keep trying to solve. Our coming into being, the great things and the weird things and the talents of the individual person each of us turns out to be, isn't just a matter of the sperm and egg pairing up. It's also a matter of how what has come before recombines and is totally changed, but also in some way survives in us. In terms of our DNA, we aren't any more related to most of our ancestors back through time than we are to people on the subway or at a baseball game or at the mall. And yet, without each of the people who came before us, who contributed to the genes that ultimately contributed to ours, we wouldn't exist in the way we do now. So I'm interested in the gray areas of ancestry, the places where we look to records and increasingly to science and genetics for answers to really complicated questions that we'll probably only ever know the answers to in part. Why are some of us beautiful and some of us plain, some of us athletic and some of us clumsy, some of us depressive and some of us optimistic? How much can our genes really tell us about these things? And what does all our scrambling to find our destinies written in our genes say about us? Even in the Western world, once upon a time, the separation between the living family and the dead was not nearly so stark. People believed the spirits of dead ancestors haunted the living world and required respect and appeasement. Ancestor veneration seems weird to us now, like something that only happens in other parts of the world. But for many people, going back through time, it was a major way people made sense of the world and their place in it. These practices were intended to appease the dead and to ensure the peace and prosperity of the living. So the modern world allows each of us to define our own identities and to have our own ambitions, and at least in theory, the freedom not to be boxed in by what's come before us. We're not obligated to glorify our ancestors blindly or to view their lives as destiny, which is all to the good. But in turning away from the structures that encoded into familial memory the people who came before us, we gave up something huge. And now, in our scientific age, we're looking for our ancestors through our genes, trying to control the manifestations of their legacies with science, and not realizing that the impulses behind our searches and efforts aren't always rational. So the book I'm writing is about my own experiences and discoveries, my fears about what exactly our parents do pass down, It branches into the experiences of my friends and of writers and artists and historical figures and celebrities. It considers the broad sweep of ancestry from antiquity to the present day. It draws from science history, philosophy, psychology, and reporting. It refers freely to superstition and discredited science, as well as seemingly uncanny coincidences and echoes, arguing that even as we increasingly view ancestry as a science, our understanding of our inheritance remains incomplete, and that for many of us, the allure of the art has a lot in common with a good ghost story. So I'd like to thank you all for coming out, and I would really, well, there was AJ at the end. I'd like to thank AJ and the organizers for underscoring the ways that we're all connected to each other.